Good evening. I gather it's been a long day, and it's probably not the most interesting topic to wind your day with, but let me try and keep it interesting. Kali, thank you for inviting me to speak here this evening at this India Today Conclave. I think the last time I was invited to the India Today Conclave was in 2011, where I was a co-speaker with Arun Shori and KP Singh of DLF to discuss the intersection of business and politics. And I remember that was quite an eventful conversation that we had. Well, today's topic is a bit tamer in comparison, at least it looks like that. Topic of privacy in general and digital privacy in particular. It's an important milestone in my own digital political advocacy, and has been at the core of my political work, which has included spectrum options, freedom of expression online, quality of service, net neutrality, better regulatory institutions, stronger consumer rights, all areas that I've enthusiastically championed, even at times when there wasn't much support or traction for these issues in mainstream media or parliament. But let's be clear, things have come to a boil as Digital India has catalyzed a rapid expansion of onlining. And as over, you know, we have about 30 crore Indians online today, and over the next maybe two and a half, three years, we expect about 80 crores or 800 million Indians to come online, transforming India from being one of the largest unconnected nations in the world to becoming one of the largest online nations. And so therefore, the awareness of the challenges and the problems that come along with it are increasingly coming to the fore. I remember many years ago, and I think we were just discussing just before this with a smaller group, being the sole voice in Parliament speaking up against the problem that the Aadhaar that the UPA was trying to introduce represented. That crores of people were being online, their information was being online with a kind of a canned narrative and a rush for numbers, without addressing other issues relating to both privacy, security, and even integrity. And in many ways, Aadhaar was a classic example of how a government system would push for technology in governance without addressing key bits of the ecosystem around the citizen and the consumer. If that wasn't enough, the IT Act and its Section 66A and its language and its vagueness and its potential for misuse was another example of the faults of a bureaucracy or a political system trying to legislate or create solutions in the digital world. So before I speak about privacy or indeed the broader issue of consumer rights in the digital world, let's step back and understand India's journey into the digital age. All of you know that the biggest success story in Indian infrastructure today is the story of Indian telecom, where global standard infrastructure and technology have been deployed at almost no cost to the taxpayers, and has instead and in turn created not just jobs but crores of revenues to the government, and also helped a whole new technology industry on the back of that. It is actually amazing to realize, and I was just sharing that with talking before, first cellular license was signed 25 years ago, almost to the day. But the reason I bring that up is that despite the obvious successes of the telecom sector and having over 1 billion Indians connected, the basic issues around consumer rights remain. That is why we saw a few months and years ago this spectacle of call drops with a hapless regulator and a government struggling to get telecom operators to be more accountable to their consumers, hamstrung with legislative weaknesses in the TRAI Act. I am bringing this up to explain the general approach of the government system, that consumers and consumer rights are almost never the principal focus of public policy, especially in the digital space. It is only in recent times with RERA, for example, the Real Estate Regulatory Authority Act, that consumers are getting to get real rights embedded in law. That is why governments and bureaucrats tend to pass laws with Section 66A or Plan Aadhaar with no protection absolutely for the consumer. It's a command and control mindset that has at its basis years of a certain way of looking at consumers and citizens. But as I said, as more and more Indians go online for entertainment, for commerce, for governance, for information, more the need for the government and policymakers to proactively address the issues of the rights and protection. So take the three issues of Section 66A, Aadhaar and privacy. All of these issues relate to a digital consumer's right to expression and or to his or her privacy. But do you see how in all of them, it is not the parliament, it is not the government that is taking the leads, but it is the courts. It is telling that there is a genuine lack of understanding or capacity within the government and media about the need to understand these vital issues and be ahead of the curve rather than behind. I say this with some experience at the uphill struggle to start a debate and discussion on all these three issues, including within media over the last 5 to 7 years. Even on the issue of Section 66A, regular media, conventional media did not step up to the plate till the first arrests were made of a cartoonist in Mumbai. So obviously today, I am pleased at where we are today. More and more debate and discussion on what are the do's and don'ts in the online world. What rights can a digital Indian realistically seek and get? These are good discussions to have. Of course, there will be people in the system, and I'll call this the system, that will try and oppose this. And the use of the word national security is often the reason that there is an attempt to deflect a proper rational conversation about these issues. But as President Obama said famously, I think in 2007, and I quote, "Reject the notion that there is a choice that needs to be made between freedom and national security." I too believe this. This is not a or B. These two issues can coexist and must coexist. So while we have spoken about whether it's Section 66A, net neutrality, call drops, Aadhaar, and we have been, as a country, successful in pushing digital policy on where it should go, the latest win of the Supreme Court finding the privacy is a fundamental right is a big, big deal. And it will alter a number of things going forward. So let me just dwell on this issue of privacy as a fundamental right and what the implications of the Supreme Court order is. First of all, I just want to make clear that data privacy and privacy in the digital world is not an elitist issue. There is a attempt to characterize this as some kind of an elitist issue, and it is not. It becomes more and more important as more and more Indians come online and consumers do not have adequate protection against the misuse of data or information. I actually introduced a private member's bill on privacy way back in 2010. It didn't catch anybody's notice, and like with most private members' bill, it died a natural death in Parliament. Subsequently, I became a petitioner in challenging Aadhaar in 2013. And interestingly enough, it is the challenge of Aadhaar where an argument was made by my lawyers and of course other lawyers that Aadhaar was in a way violating the right to privacy, and the government council at that time took a position in the Supreme Court that privacy was not a fundamental right and therefore Aadhaar could violate it, that the Supreme Court then referred the question of is privacy a fundamental right to a 9-judge bench. And my arguments were based in this petition on the need to assert and establish the right to privacy as a fundamental right, not as an absolute right. And the difference between the fundamental right and an absolute right is that it is a fundamental right subject to reasonable restrictions. And if you, I don't know how many of you remember this, all of this was predicated in my mind by instances and incidents that happened way back in 2011-2012. In 2011-2012, if you recall, the leader of opposition at that time had his call records accessed by a low-level police detective or a private detective, which was one instance of a glaring instance of violation of privacy. There was also an allegation at that time of a telecom company that was injecting code into the micro browsers of smartphones to track and record browsing history of its consumers without consent of the consumers. So there was clearly a pattern that consumers and the consumer data were being collected by companies in violation of, without any consent of the particular consumer. So this 24 December 2017, the Supreme Court ruled privacy is a fundamental right subject to reasonable restrictions. It is a milestone without any, without, you know, having to say it any other word, any other way. And I quote, it said, the right to privacy is protected as an intrinsic part of the right to life and personal liberty under Article 21 and as a part of the freedoms guaranteed by Part 3 of the Constitution. And it is a, it's a, it's a beautifully written judgment. It has two of the brightest judges in our Supreme Court today, really writing some excellent, really must-read stuff in that judgment. But let's be clear, this is a first step only, a big first step. The legal ecosystem and precedents around privacy and digital privacy will evolve in the coming months and years. What constitutes reasonable restrictions? These will be argued by various people in various forums, in various courts, in terms of defining the contours of the fundamentalness of privacy as a fundamental right. So let me quickly end by broadly predicting what this means for all of us going forward. As I said, it is subject to reasonable restrictions. It means that what it may mean, and this will be tested, as you know, in November, the Aadhaar petition is coming up for hearing in the Supreme Court. My own view is that it will evolve in the following manner, that citizens will have an obligation to provide data to states, will have obligation to provide data to those private entities that are delivering services to them. But these entities, whether they are state or these private entities, will have clear obligations on how they collect, how they store, how they manage the above data, and how they reuse it. It will also mean that the giver of the data will have explicit rights of consent on the reuse of the data for any other purpose other than what he or she has volunteered the data. So for example, in the Aadhaar case, since that's the most visible symbol of a data collector, if Aadhaar as UIDI has sought your biometrics as part of your Aadhaar enrollment and wants to use that data for any other purpose, it will necessarily need to seek explicit consent for that purpose. I would argue, and this will have to be tested again in the Supreme Court, that such a fundamental right also means that there is some obligations cast on the custodian of the user data. So for example, if a state entity or a private entity misuses, leaks, fails to protect the data, it would be legally liable and be in contravention of its, of the data giver's fundamental right to privacy. So what I am arguing today is, or what I am putting forth is, that this finding that privacy is a fundamental right creates for the first time obligations and responsibilities for all entities, government or private, that deal with information of Indian citizens. This will clearly redefine the relationship between consumer and those companies and state entities that collect data about consumers. This will reset the current asymmetry between the two. And I hear from the government that they are planning a new data protection law to achieve the same thing. So let me end this by saying the full import of this judgment will be seen and felt over the coming years in the digital world, also in the non-digital world. In the non-digital world, the impact of the judgment will be far-reaching. The rights of an individual over his or her body and to take decisions without fear of being observed and scrutinized are also now explicitly protected. This will be increasingly asserted by citizens. One obvious area is the contentions aspect of Section 377 and sexual preferences of citizens. I have absolutely no doubt that this area too we will see testing and progress. So I'll end by saying the Supreme Court verdict establishing privacy as a fundamental right is a big deal and is a welcome step. It has embedded digital consumers' rights within the Constitution. Protecting this right and developing this in the age of technology would be extremely appropriate for a nation that is the world's largest democracy and will soon be the world's largest digital democracy. Thank you. Jai Hind.